talk about our a huge project for us at the town of Sackville. And I think it leads in nicely to Serge's introduction. I am an urban planner by trade. This is mainly an engineering project, and I just want everyone to know how serious I am about planning in general. I'm not just the president of the New Brunswick Association of Planners, but I also have it firmly stamped on my little lunch container. It says, "Urban planning changed the world." So it's my little self-reminder every day as I'm going to work that what we do at the local government level is really important. So anyone in the room before we start, does anyone know where Lord Street is? It's okay if you don't. If anyone knows where the Via Rail Station is in Sackville, we're talking about that general area. So I'm going to talk briefly about the problem, which I think everyone knows. The solution, the project, the current status, and then we'll have a brief chance for questions. Talk briefly about the problem, which I think everyone knows. The solution, the project, the current status, and then we'll have a brief chance for questions. So anytime I ask a question, I've got the Town of Sackville lip balm made locally by an ointment skincare in Sackville. So any guesses on some door prizes? Whenever you're following Serge, you need to have gifts because he usually steals the show. Any ideas of what the problem is on Lord Street?
Water.
This one goes to the meteorologist. So yeah, we've got a water problem. We've got a serious water problem, and we look back at some of the old photos. It's a combination of both sea level rise and breaching of the dikes at one point, and the Saxby Gale. But today, mainly, what I'm going to be talking about is some of the freshwater flooding concerns that we've had on Lord Street. This is basically taken at the bottom of my lower driveway. I live in the flood zone. I live on St. James Street, which is runs perpendicular to Lord Street. So I've been a resident of Sackville. I've been a resident of St. James Street for over 10 years. And so I guess the project especially hits home to my wife and I. So again, this is the Bowser's Construction Building. So this is kind of the center of the universe for Lawrence Street. This is the lowest part of the drainage basin in Sackville. So we have I have a map coming up here shortly, which I'll show you what some of the problem is. But we've got a lot of things happening. All of our storm system is emptying into the Lawrence Street marsh. And then I guess compounding that, we have the main CN rail line cutting through the Lawrence Street area. So we have, not just businesses and residences in the floodplain, we also have the major CN rail line. And if anyone, pays attention to intermodal transport, we have a lot of goods and services going through our community. You know, 7-8 trains a day, miles long. This is a piece of national critical infrastructure, I think, sometimes that people forget about when they think about Sackville, but the CN rail line is certainly an important part of it. And then I guess what's interesting for us is that we have all this fresh water entering into Lawrence Street, and then we're a tidal community. So Sarah's mentioned the abattoirs, and this is just an example of one of them where I think everyone understands the principle when the Acadian dikes, when the tide is in, the gate is shut. When the tide is out, all the storm water, the fresh water can then empty, and it pushes usually the flapper, metal flapper gate out. So it's an old piece of engineering, and it still works. So I guess part of we have more, I guess, urban scape. We have a lot more hard asphalt, more buildings, less green infrastructure that's able to absorb that stormwater. We have the CN rail, and this is just an example of where the stormwater is coming from, how big this drainage basin is. So this is Lawrence Street, right here. This is my house. Should be the center of the universe. So this is a huge drainage basin, and it goes way up on King Street. It's not even captured by this map. So this is what we've used to kind of present to some government departments to show how big this is and how important it is for our community and for the, I guess, and really also the protection of the CN. So you have a problem. Anyone want to take a crack at what the solution may be?
Holding pond?
That was yours. So we'll get to the holding ponds. But for us mainly, it was a, it was, came down to money. And I guess we had to look strategically of how we leverage money for, you know, an over $8 million project when our operational budget is only $10 million. We need to be realistic. So we have a, we worked with EOS, and you know, much to Amanda's credit, we produced a corporate climate change adaptation plan. And in that plan, I guess front and center was to resolve the flooding issue on Lawrence Street. And then secondly, council recently adopted a strategic plan, and front and center in that strategic plan is the need to find a solution to the stormwater issues on Lawrence Street. So we use those, you know, corporate type documents to then prove and help illustrate to provincial and federal governments that we understand it's a problem, we know we need a solution, and we then use that to help leverage some money. And we did. And we did it in two phases. The first phase dealt with kind of the unsexy bit of Lawrence Street, which was the underground infrastructure, pipes, ditches. You know, I think that stuff is, you know, it's not sexy because mainly we don't see a lot of it. And then phase two, which I'll talk a bit about later, which is a series of holding ponds to be able to store the water. So again, this is the general area that we're talking about. So what we did is we, the first phase, I guess the unsexy stuff, was about $5.3 million. So again, half our operational budget in one shot. So we broke the phase one project up into two contracts. So one dealt with kind of everything you see here on the red line. So sorry, this is the phase one diagram. So everything in the red line is considered phase one. And then we broke that project up into two separate phases and did two separate tenders to be able to get the work done in a timely fashion. So the second part of the contract was Dexter Construction and Beal & Lynch, and that was a lot of the work in and around the St. James Street area. So essentially what that was was a full reconstruction of a major portion of St. James Street, a new trunk sewer line from Lawrence Street out towards Charles Street, and an access road, which you can see down here on the south side of the drawing. And we've had a lot of people ask us, why are you building these roads? You know, you're looking to solve a drainage issue. And I guess the access roads are meant to be able to allow our equipment to go in and service these areas in the event that we need to dig something up and get equipment in. We have lots of infrastructure, we have loads of easements around where we actually can't even access them. We have to build a road to be able to get to them. So we want it to be proactive, so that if we need to get a long neck excavator in there to dig out a ditch and keep it maintained, we have the ability to do that. So unfortunately, I don't have any photos before the snow, but this is just as we were kind of in the last stretches of the access road. So we've got a truck sewer along the right-hand side. This is another view of the access road. This is just as we were getting ready to start doing the finish grade on St. James Street. And then part of the phase one contract was also a series of large drainage ditches along the old CN rail line. So these had been there and act as natural drainage systems for a long, long time. They had never been maintained. We have a gentleman in our public works department for over 30 years. They can never remember an excavator being down there digging a ditch. So we've had a great relationship with CN Rail. A really great relationship with CN Rail. They've come to the table, which I'm going to talk a bit about as part of phase two, but they allowed us to go on the property and dig the ditches. Of course, it's to their benefit too, of course, because there's the rail lines there. And then the other contract went to Bowser's Construction. So Bowser's was mainly responsible for Lawrence Street. So they were responsible for Lawrence Street from Bridge Street all the way to Queens Road. So, and again, that was the same type of project. That was a complete street reconstruction, so underground infrastructure. You can see now we the light is finally at the end of the tunnel for that least phase of Lawrence Street that we've replaced everything. And I guess I'm really happy to say that the project was on time and on budget, which for municipal government is really, really important. You know, it's one thing to say that we've got a flooding problem, we need to fix it. But when you add the business component, so we have Strutt's Gallery, we have apartment buildings, we have the Cookie Cutter Bakery, who have regular shipments coming in, we have passenger rail, we've got our major sports fields, we've got a school bus route. It becomes more than just kind of managing the stormwater project. There's also this huge communications piece that you need to be able to manage kind of off the side of your desk. So these are just a few shots as we were getting ready to start the final base of Lawrence Street. So you can see the curb work was just finished. So we hit the finish line with Lawrence Street and with phase one of Lawrence Street. And we get that wrapped up. We were on time and on budget, so we were happy to close that up towards the end of November. So phase two, and someone already said what's the solution was the stormwater retention pond. So phase two is once we received got word that we received funding for phase one, which was the 5.3, we were then encouraged to apply with another shovel-ready project, which was phase two, to the same fund. So they got back to us and said, we know you have an application for phase one. We understand in your application there's a subsequent phase. We still have money left over in the pot. So if you have a shovel-ready project, we're willing to take more applications. So we worked with our consulting company, Crandall Engineering, and got phase two in and submitted, and we were successful. So we received another $2.3 million for Lawrence Street phase two. So I'm going to be here all day talking about Lauren, phase two. This is the sexy part. This is the fun part. I'll try to be quick and Sabine just wave if I'm getting close to time. But, so you can see the label these kind of pond one on the top, pond two directly underneath that, and then pond three a little over the side. So part of the tricky part for us in terms of being able to manage and store the water was that we didn't own the property. So we have been working for at least, God, it's got to be at least 8, if not 10 months, working collaboratively with a lot of private property owners in our community to try and lock up some of this property, be able to undertake and build these ponds. So that's what we've, that's what, mainly what I've been up to over the last 6 to 8 months. So we've approached Ducks Unlimited for pond one. And I guess we part of our vision for this is that we have an award-winning waterfowl park. The waterfowl park isn't just a lovely place to walk from boardwalks. It serves a very important engineering function that stores water and then bleeds that water off during the day. So when it rains and you were to go down, heavy rainfall or extreme rainfall, as Serge talked about, you were to go down to the waterfowl park, you'd see a rise in the water level, and then shortly thereafter, the water level would recede down to normal level. So it's a wet retention pond. And really what we wanted to be able to do is to be able to link these areas together with this new phase two of Lawrence Street. So we've approached Ducks Unlimited on pond one, and Ducks Unlimited has committed to working with us to develop that into a wet pond, as per their spec. So that will capture the runoff in and around, especially from Bridge Street, and we're hoping to be able to tie in a bit of that coming from Welland Street as well. So that's pond one, which would be really an extension of our waterfowl park. And then I guess our main priority is pond two. So we need to be able to get the water to the ditch that Gene had mentioned. We have all this water coming down, emptying into a ditch. We have a new drainage ditch constructed. And then the idea is for that ditch to then lead and dump the water into a holding pond, which would then have an outlet control structure that would allow us to bleed that water off when the tide comes out. So the tide's in, the gate's closed, the rain stops, the bathtub fills up, holds the water, the tide goes out, the floodgate, the flapper gate opens on the dike, and we can empty the water out into the Bay of Fundy. So we actually have to get the water from Lawrence Street to the Bay of Fundy. And I guess what we wanted to do was, we wanted to pick a spot, A, that had the right geodetic elevation to make this all work. Water has to run. We're not interested in pumping water from point A to point B. We need this all to work by gravity. So we had the provincial departments accept the proposed location of the abattoir, kind of the mouth of the river. We know that there's parts of the river that are silting up, and we want to make sure the abattoir is a place where it's going to continue to be flushed out, and it's not going to get silted, so that water will be able to continue to flow. The elevation analysis on the proposed location by our lagoons was positive. We did have a large component of town-owned land, so if I just look back to the drawing, the pond three would actually be on our property. So it would be out behind the community garden. So we own a big chunk of land there, which meant it made it a bit easier to kind of get the stormwater from point A being Lawrence Street out to point B being the Bay of Fundy. And one of the other things the consulting team liked about the engineer design was that there was an ability to kind of separate the drainage basins. So when I say that separating the drainage basins, this is where currently all the stormwater on Lawrence Street is going. It's a small little abattoir behind the Via Rail station. And it's getting bottlenecked between several culverts and then another culvert under the CN rail line. So once we take a lot of the water and we move that from, say, Dufferin, Wellington, Allison Avenue, and we start pushing that out towards our public works department through the holding ponds, that will alleviate some of the water volumes that are currently going down Dufferin out to behind the Via Rail station. So it allows us to not have to necessarily worry at the present time about upgrading that infrastructure, but that infrastructure will function as it should based on the reduced water volume. So separating the drainage basins was a huge win. And then finally, of course, the ability to expand the waterfowl park and include some walking trails. So while they are access roads, we've already seen a significant amount of people using them for walking trails, which is what we really wanted. So we still have some work to do on that in the new year as part of phase one, and then we'll pick that up as part of phase two. So where are we currently? I'll start with this. Is that the second phase of Lawrence Street, because the abattoir is we have currently have an abattoir leading over to the Bay of Fundy. What we're proposing to do is to take that abattoir out and put in a new double structure with two gates on top of each other. And the Bay of Fundy is a provincially significant wetland. So that portion of the work has triggered an environmental impact assessment, which we expected. But I guess the scope of the project is so big it does have an impact on the environment. It's our responsibility to manage it. So the whole project right now, phase two, is under environmental impact assessment, which we're going through now. So we had a public meeting in November. And our consultants are just kind of in the final legs of kind of the back and forth with the review team at the Department of Environment before we can get a certificate of determination from the minister to be able to proceed with phase two. So once we have a certificate of determination issued and the environmental impact assessment process is finished, we'll then go to tender for phase two. So keep in mind, we haven't gotten into tender with this yet. These are just plans. We're still finalizing the design review and engineer drawings to be able to pull off phase two. We'll then go to tender, close the project, and we're hoping to start construction through the winter of this year, in 2018. And I guess we see that as a benefit, both from the environmental side, that working through the winter when the ground is hard has less of a disruption on the natural environment, but also we know that a lot of the construction crews are not working during the winter, not working as much during the winter, so we'll have our fingers crossed and get a competitive pricing. So one of the big questions is always, well, what are the stormwater ponds going to look like? And, I don't want to steal Adam's thunder. I know he's going to be talking a bit about the naturalized stormwater retention ponds, but we have engaged a landscape architect to help us on the design of the ponds because it's inherently clear from the community that we don't want to build a Hildegard retention pond. I used to work for the city of Moncton, so I feel like I can single that area out. But we don't want to just dig a big hole in the ground, hydro seed and then build a fence. We don't want to have a fence. We see these being a passive recreational area that people can use and enjoy, and really extending our waterfowl park and creating another asset for the community. So that work is underway now, which as we move through the finalized engineering design, the landscape architecture feature of the ponds will become the very next important step.
Thank you.